evening, everyone. Glad to see everybody here tonight. Some new faces tonight that haven't been here for a couple nights. We're glad to have you here. Glenn, Carol, I'm glad to have you up here playing with us. Ruth, you guys, I hope you were able maybe to catch some of it through the video feed, but these guys have been real great. They blessed our hearts, and you will be blessed tonight. I promise. I guarantee it. If not, I'll take them out back and whoop them. How's that sound? With that. Hannah, did you get banned to the back for some reason? Oh, okay. You're videoing. I thought he just banned you to the back, you know. You go back there. I don't want to be associated with you, so you sit in the back. Kind of idea. All right. Okay. Very good. All right. Just a couple announcements. Tomorrow's our final day. Adult Sunday school class and all those associated in that kind of range, from teenagers on up there, will be meeting here. And Trent will be teaching us there. He's got a lot on his plate with that. And it's going to teach us the whole Bible in 45 minutes kind of idea with us. But that's his job. That's what he'll be doing with Sunday school with us. But we will be meeting in here. We'll have a quick offering, actually passing the plates. Haven't done that in quite a while. That will happen. And then I'll have one song, and then he'll take over from there. And then in the 11 o'clock or 10 o'clock hour, Brother Ben will be taking over and preaching in that hour and sharing with us that hour. And then we'll have lunch. Then after lunch, we'll be coming back over here having a 1 o'clock service, no 6 o'clock service. And you'll hear both of them again at the 1 o'clock and their places where they're going to, I don't know what exactly both of them got planned, but where they're planning for us at the end there, that will be the grand finale, so to speak. So a lot of fireworks going on at that one, for sure, with that, all right? That's all the announcements I'm going to make. As I go to the throne here tonight, before we begin, you're going to hear a couple of special requests. Lori is extremely ill, my heart's going out with her four little kids that she's trying to raise, and she's not quite as old as I am, but pretty close with it. I just can't imagine it with it, but that's what she's trying to do and survive the sickness that she's got. So I'm going to be praying for her, and I'm going to pray for my cousin. His wife has got some serious issues with both knees, and she's unable to even get out of bed right now. And he's, a truck driver. So he's doing all this driving and going approximately about 80 hours a week right now just to be back home to be able to help her in that process too with that. So you'll hear those two as we go to the throne of the Almighty. Let's go to his throne. Almighty God, once again, you have blessed us tremendously the last couple nights. We are really excited about tonight and what you're doing in these young men's lives, Lord, and how that you have been working, what you're planning for them. Lord, and the direction, we were just tickled to have them both here, that you have brought them into our lives. And Lord, I pray that that once again you will bless us through them tonight. We look forward to what they bring to us. And I pray that we've been in our fellowship and with them, and just the time we spent with them has been a blessing to them also. And so we just lift them up before you and ask that the power of the Holy Spirit, your almighty powerful Spirit, would be upon them, Lord, as they bring forth your direction through them and to us, Lord, and that we would have ears that are open and ready to hear, Lord, and I just pray that your hand would be upon them tonight. I pray for Jordan, Lord, who has made it down to Emmanuel. He's got a meeting tonight and then a couple in the morning there at the church. And so I just pray your hand would be upon him and that we would see Emmanuel take them on and further their support with them and get them one step closer to Benin. Lord, and I just pray your hand would be upon them. And then I pray for Lori. And I really don't know how she does it. I mean, it's enough energy sometimes to have my grandkids over and watching them for a couple hours. But to do it 24-7, Lord, it's unbelievable. And I know that she's really, really ill right now. And so, Lord, I just pray that your powerful Spirit would just rest upon her and that you just touch and heal her and raise her up and just remove this sickness that she's been dealing with for approximately about a week, maybe a week and a half, Lord, that you just touch and heal her completely from that. And then I pray for Deb and her knees and the situation with that, and I pray that your hand would be upon her, Lord, and that she would be able to get those corrected. I don't know exactly the whole story, what's going on, but I know it's really putting a lot of pressure on my cousins. So, Lord, I just pray that your hand would be upon both of them. And then I think of the McTaggart family, and I know I didn't exactly mention them, but they are on my heart, Lord, and Earl's back home, and a lot of pressure on Eileen, Lord. And so I just pray that your hand would be upon that whole situation, Lord. And you know their needs, their daily needs, better than any one of us. And so I just pray that your hand would be upon them through this whole time. Lord, now as we come and we lift our voices before you, we pray that it just brings glory and honor to your wonderful and awesome name. And that, Lord, you will be pleased with our songs, what's coming from our hearts. And Lord, it would not just be lip service, but this is truly something that we sing from our hearts to you that we want to accomplish, you to accomplish actually through us. And we pray this in the almighty precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. We're going to start out tonight on the song 440. 440, So Send I You by Grace Made Strong. 440. Jesus saves. It's not us. It's not these two guys and their wives and soon to be multiple children over here for sure. It's not them. Jesus is the one saved. It's not pastor, not me. We are heralds. We proclaim. We give the truth. Same with these two men. Jesus Christ is the one that does the save. So as we sing this, let that be a reminder to us. We have a responsibility to be heralds, proclaimers of the Word of God. Jesus saves.
We have heard the joyful sound. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Spread the tidings all around. Jesus saves. Thank you.
up a theme song on it. Stand with me, if you will. And if you remember, we are going to change that millions to billions. All right? That's in the first line there. We will be singing billions instead of millions. Here we go.
Two nights, you have missed a couple real blessings each night. Both of these men have been superb, blessing the heart, challenging us, and I just pray that you guys are keep right on doing what you're doing. And I'm looking forward tonight. I need my toes stomped on, and I look forward to what you have to share with us tonight. So Trenton is on first, and then Ben is on second. I haven't figured out who's on third yet, but Joe's on third, and so, anyways, gentlemen, it's yours. Lord bless you.
So again, my name is Trenton. It's so wonderful again to be here another night in the house of God, to be able to share this message that's been placed on our hearts, and it's just so amazing to see new faces today and be able to be in the presence of the Lord. So I just wanted to say for tomorrow, if you do plan on being here, I highly encourage you. Tomorrow's going to be awesome and also very sad that tomorrow will be our last day being here for this week. But we plan on having a wonderful relationship with you as we continue to serve Christ, as we're called to other churches and serving. So I encourage you tomorrow at 9 a.m. For the Bible study hour. Hannah and I will both be sharing our testimonies and also leading into how no matter what age you are, you can come to Christ and still serve Him just as Saul did during his conversion to Paul. And it's just amazing to be able to share these messages with you. So before we get started, I'd love to pray and bring this to the Lord. Dear God, thank you for this awesome opportunity to be able to be in your house today and share your word. I thank you for moving through us and giving us the Holy Spirit, and I thank you for your Son. Just salvation is just so amazing, and I thank you for working in all of us to be able to just feel your power. Thank you for allowing us to be a temple for your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So today, this message was laid on my heart probably a few weeks ago. If you know me, I was actually quite nervous when it came, anytime that it comes to public speaking. But again, this is just a testament to how God works in our lives. I never thought that I was going to be standing up here speaking to a bunch of people. But God had a way to work through that and get me out of my comfort zone. But with that, we also learned some new things as well. And something that I learned was how to be a humble servant. And so I present this to you today. When I was praying and meditating on this message, God laid it on my heart to speak about the covenant that he made between him and his people, the Israelites, or the Jews. And this came from the tribe of Jacob. As I read more in Chronicles, the more I realized that as a nation and as a people, we have not changed. We are fairly the same throughout history. We can attest that to our flesh, to very sinful desires, and such and such. But one thing that remains the same, that hasn't changed, is God. And God has still been faithful and still wants us to work with us and have a relationship with him. And the biggest thing that I want to stress here, and I just love this because, you know, in our lives we see, they need us. God doesn't need us. He wants us. And I love that, and that just makes me want to jump for joy that we have a God. That we learned yesterday is, again, we're recognizing that power of how awesome he is and all that power that he has, and yet he still wants us. And so we're going to be touching on that again today. That he is still faithful and wants that relationship with us. And it's so amazing. And I tried to envision myself in how God sees and in God's shoes. And you can see that his patience is extraordinary. I know that some of our parents know that patience is hard. I know that patience is hard. I'm not a patient person. But God teaches me to be a patient person. Through the people that he's put in the Bible before us, he's taught them patience, and I can learn from them on patience as well. And the same is with being a servant. And I'd like to talk about Solomon and his speaking to God in 2 Chronicles today to evaluate why God is saying what he's saying in this passage. And how that applies to us as Christians in our everyday life. And how we can build off of this. So many times, like we talked yesterday, for some Christians, this is not everyone, but for some Christians, we receive salvation, and then that's the end. We don't learn what's next. We might learn about Jesus, we might learn about the disciples. But for me, as a young Christian, when I had first started coming to Christ, I didn't know what was next. And that's very dangerous. That can be a very dangerous road to go down. Because then you can get lost. And you can quite literally do the opposite of what God wants you to do. And so, for this, it's just the beginning. Salvation is just the beginning for us. And then that's when we learn what our Christian's mission is, like yesterday. And for today, we learn how to be a humble servant that he calls us to be. So what does that look like in our lives? Well, like we saw in Romans 12, 1 and 2, it's being a living sacrifice. It calls us to sacrifice some or to sacrifice much. One of those many things God calls of us as his body is to be a humble servant. So please join me in 2 Chronicles 7, 14. And the scripture says, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. 2 Chronicles 7:14. So in this conversation, it's good to understand where this is coming from, who it's being directed to, and so on and so forth. This was the divine covenant between Solomon, the nation of Israel, and the Lord our God. At this time, Solomon has already given sacrifices in the court and all. After Solomon finished the house of the Lord in the king's house, the Lord appeared to Solomon at night. And to backtrack a little bit, 2 Chronicles 1:4-7, we can see what that place looked like. So now David had brought the Ark of God from Kirjath-Jearim to the place he had prepared for it, because he had pitched a tent for it in Jerusalem. But the bronze altar made by Bezalel, son of Uri, the son of Hur, was in Gibeon before the tabernacle of the Lord. So Solomon and the assembly inquired of him there. Solomon offered sacrifices there before the Lord on the bronze altar in the tent of the meeting, where he offered 1,000 burnt offerings. That night, God appeared to Solomon and said, "Ask, and what will I give to you?" And this is at the moment where he was asking God for wisdom and knowledge, because he was pleasing to God. His heart was of God at this time. And so he was blessed with knowledge and wisdom from prayer, as God asked him what he would like, and God liked his response, as it was non-glorifying way personally, as his heart was in the right place. And we see that he was humble in this aspect, as he was thinking about Israel and how to lead Israel the way that God would want him to. Solomon was looking to use this gift God blessed him with to bless the nation of Israel with just judging, as God has, to lead God's people in a rightful direction. And it's great to read this about the covenants that God establishes with his people, all out of love, right? So he truly shows his character through the Bible, and this is an evidence of that. Excuse me. At the time I was writing this, it was about probably 1 o'clock in the morning. I always find myself reading my Bible just in the middle of the night, and it's so quiet and peaceful, and I just have a moment to be one with God in that time. I have a communion with him. And it's just, I feel my outside sources of life are the quietest. I'm able to have my one-on-one with him. And he speaks to me through his spirit, as he, the same God, had conversations with Adam, Moses, David, Solomon, you name it. But these were, in Old Testament, were more like physical presence or through speaking of the spirit and so on and so forth. So just a bit of a side note, just wanted to escalate how important that is for us as believers to know that God has not changed, and he still continues to speak with us through his Holy Spirit. And he is faithful. And we just got a glimpse of that just the other day, the power of the Almighty when thinking about our mission as Christians. And we see that God's promises then in the Old Testament and New Testament still reign true in the church age, which we're in right now, and we can still continue to reign true until the return of the Almighty. And we've actually seen some of his promises come to fruition. And so, the Lord was making this covenant between Solomon and his people, as we said, to get them to turn from their evil and seek him over all. David had to continue that covenant as well. In the First Chronicles, David had had a covenant between God and was later on passed through Solomon. But as David had passed, Solomon had come. We learned in like 1 Kings that Solomon had 700 wives and 300 concubines, and he turned his heart from God and followed his wives' gods. So, God told him to take that he would take the kingdom from him and give him but one tribe as promised to keep to David, and that was, as we later realized, as Israel. He had been warned 2 times prior to this, and he was commanded not to do this, to follow his wives, and the Lord appeared to him in these warnings. And when I was thinking about that, I was like, wow, how can God appear to you, and he's telling you, hey, don't do this, don't do this. And he's like, seeing him, I'm like, wow, okay, and then he goes and does it. But then I'm thinking, well, more realistically, at the time, only a select few which I have a list here of a select few of people being selected to receive the Holy Spirit in the Old Testament that were able to do God's will through the Holy Spirit. And the rest, we'd have to work through the fleshly desires, but also trying to turn their heart to God. And I can see where that can be a struggle, where someone is dealing with their flesh, but also trying to serve God. Because we see that nowadays, right? We're trying to serve God, but our flesh gets in the way, and it's like two rabid dogs. One wants to be over the other, and one wants to win, but the one you feed is always going to win. So what are we feeding, you know? We have to remember that when we want to be a humble servant, is what side are we feeding? Are we feeding the Holy Spirit, reading our Bible, serving Him, or are we feeding the flesh, simple desires, and such like that? So in 2 Kings 23:13 as well, the high places that were before Jerusalem, which were on the right hand of the Mount of Corruption, which Solomon the king of Israel had builded for Ashtoreth, the abomination of the Zidonians, and for Chemosh, the abomination of the Moabites, and for Milcom, the abomination of the children of Ammon, did the king defile. And so he was building these horrible buildings to these other gods of the wives. And so primarily, these were fulfilling selfish desires and deeds, as trying to please his many, many wives and concubines, and doing what he wanted. And when fulfilling these desires and deeds, we fill the place in which the Holy Spirit dwells in us. As we can see from nowadays, when we do have access to the Holy Spirit, because Christ died for us and delivered us and gave us a comforter, we quench the activity of the Holy Spirit with sin, lust, not allowing God to move in our lives. So that's why we're called to put off the old man and our desires and donning on our Lord's desires and callings for our lives. We directly, indirectly are humbling ourselves in that process. And so allowing the Lord to live through us, as the salvation was a gift of not only being with Him eternally, but giving us new life. And as well, the temple was built in Jerusalem afterward with Solomon. God is reminding Solomon of when Israel forsook the Lord God, which brought them out of Egypt. And that's why these things are happening. And so, again, the Old Testament is just awesome how God works with His people, then as well as He works with us now, and we can see how that applies to us. And however we want to see it, does this apply to us? It applied to Israel and Solomon at the time, but it applies to us as well. The very first phrase of this verse, we're looking at what says, "If my people, which are called by my name." Now, let's just look at that a little bit deeper. We know that the Bible is Jesus, the Word of God made flesh. And we can see that stated in John 1:1-5. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through Him all things were made. Without Him nothing was made that has been made. In Him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. It's also stated in John 1:14, not shortly after. As the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory, the glory is of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Specifically referencing Jesus in this moment, in that sense, we can say, called by His name, as calling out the spirit of calling of Christians. We are referenced in the Old Testament in this book as well as well over. We, as followers of Christ, were first called Christians in Antioch in Acts 11:26, in which they believed in Christ and followed His teachings. Sounds a lot like us. We're Christians. We follow His teaching. We believe in Christ. But God does not live in our timeline. Therefore, He is calling specifically Israel in this moment. He's also calling us Christian. This is a very important thing to remember, that God doesn't live in our timeline. We do, and He's outside of time. God's chose, therefore, with Israel being that other half of that, they were God's chosen people. We see that in Deuteronomy 7:6. And we can make these correlations because we know that the God that we serve is calling all of His people, that this may be directly applied to our lives. And as we have reverence for our Lord, we keep our servitude. And we continue to call ourselves servants of the Most High. But a really important thing to remember about this, I think this is probably the best part of the Bible. I mean, there's arguably tons of best parts of the Bible. But do you remember what God calls us in John 15? No longer do I call you servants, for a servant does not know what his master is doing, but I have called you friends. For all things that I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you. That is awesome. I love that. And I love that when we're praying to him, we still hold this reverence and he calls us to his throne, but we still call him friend. He calls us friend. So, to continue, this does apply to us. And it is amazing that this Bible, the infallible word of God, he had commanded us to be in him. The Bible is good for all things. 2 Timothy 3:16. It also gives us a chance to learn from those before us, such as Solomon, David, and so on and so forth. So the definition of humble is having or showing a modest or a low estimate of one's own importance. And there's somebody very significant that did this. Jesus humbled himself. Right? Now, if we look at Philippians 2:8, it actually says, "And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross." So we want to limit ourselves when we're serving Christ. We don't want other things to stand out above and make it about us. Because it's about God. It's about Jesus. And so when we limit ourselves, we replicate what John the Baptist said in John 3:30. He shall increase, so we shall decrease. And we lift God up for others to see. We are servants of the Most High, so we guide the lost to him. And we should be like him. Whoever says that he abides in him ought to walk in the same way in which he walked. It's 1 John 2:6. We should want to live humbly and not to let our flesh take over. And so, as we were talking about before with the wives and the gods of their time. You know, these things still take place in our lives too. The gods of our days. Anything that we give more importance to over God becomes a god when we start putting all of our time into that thing. And so, when we read about Solomon and his wives and the many gods, we scoff and say, how could he do that? And hearing from God and he's being led by God, but we remember that we only, even a select few of them had the Spirit. And we saw that in Genesis 41:38 with Joseph. He was filled with the Spirit. The craftsman who built the tabernacle, Exodus 31:3. Joshua was filled with the Spirit in Numbers 27:18. And the judge, Othniel, was filled with the Spirit of God in Judges 3:10. And we remember that humans are fickle. And they do not stand firm. Like God, he is firm in his foundation, but we are easily waved. But that's why we were given the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, to help guide us. So, being humans that are fickle, without God, we are nothing. Look, Galatians 5:17, the verse that describes the conflict between the sinful nature and the spirit and believers. The verse says the desires of the flesh and the spirit are opposite and against each other. And that's what happens when you remove, so what happens when you remove the Spirit? Sin. Do you know that every day we make something over God? We spend time doing things that have no relevance to our King or the kingdom, and yet try to reason with ourselves why that thing is okay. and I'll speak for myself. I know I've done this. I still do it today, and it's hard. But we know that our God is better and stronger, and we give those things over to him. When we know that something is becoming a stumbling block, when we know these things are getting in the way of our relationship with the Lord, we give those things over. And that's why it's good to remember to keep that in. Am I humbling myself? Am I giving these things over to the Lord? And so, for me, I would specifically say, it's video games. Okay? Video games for me can be very, very hard. Because I get done writing a sermon, I'm like, alright, you know, I'm gonna go play a video game. And then I sit down and then I'm like, convicted. I didn't give time to God. Yes, I wrote a sermon and I was praying about it and I was working with God through that. But God doesn't want me to do work and then go do something else. I didn't give him a chance to speak. And when you sit down and read your Bible and you're praying and you're having a commune with God, that's different than working, right? It's the same thing when you with Burger King. You know, I can correlate just about anything with Burger King. I was there for like 9 years. But you could see that in a regular work life as well. Work at home is different than work at work. I see this in the same light. And, you know, video games might not be your conviction, but for me it is. And when I bring it to the Lord, He says, I want time with you, right? So instead of working, instead of putting all of my focus and working with God on this and the sermons, and He wants me to just pick up the Bible and just start reading. Not to have a direct spot where, okay, I need to go here, here, and here, just to let Him work through that moment, to have a quiet time. When you have friends, you want to have a conversation with them, right? And God calls, or Jesus calls us His friend. So if we're friends with Him, are we giving Him time for conversation? Are we giving Him time to to have a relationship with? Or are we just saying, all right, I need you for this, and then just going on and go play video games, you know? But, you know, that's where I have that conviction. And it could look like anything. It could look like books, you know, games or whatever. And if God wants that time, He will convict. And it's amazing, too, because I was looking in Exodus and what happened with when Moses came down from the mountain after his time with God. The Israelites turned to the golden calves, like almost immediately, because they thought He wasn't coming back. And they got impatient. And like in that moment, they didn't see God working. They didn't see Moses. And they're like, oh, we're lost. But we can see that God still has a plan and still working in us. He still wants a relationship with us, that we don't end up like the Israelites. And we have the Holy Spirit to work through us. And so, and if you want to read that story, it's in Exodus chapter 32, 34. And, you know, it's a great read. But to begin that process of humbling, one of the important things to remember is Ephesians 2:10, that we are His workmanship. Excuse me. Created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God had before ordained, and we should walk in them. And then again, 12:1-2, Romans 12:1-2. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but ye transform by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is good and acceptable and perfect will of God. To be that living sacrifice. It's a reasonable service for the things that God has done for us, and to give to Him. So, God wants us to admonish the lavishes of this flesh, to live in the Spirit. To be humble is to be in God's presence. Being humble allows God to work through you, on you, and around you. And other people can be blessed by that. I can't tell you how blessed I've been during this week being presented with with you as followers of Christ. Being able to come here and speak and learn alongside you these things that God has put in His Word for us. And when we put up our walls and become self-inflated, we can blow away people from God. When we let other things control our lives, we can scare them away from something so beautiful and amazing. We don't want to be the one, the stumbling block. We want to let God work through us and lead them to Him. Right? And so, something I'd leave you on tonight to remember. God's promise, grains rooted, no matter if you say it does or doesn't. God's promise is there. And He calls us to admonish our gods, to lay them aside, to give them up, to give them away. There are things that can bless us to worship God, and God will put them in our paths, in our lives, in which He will bless us with. We don't need to make up things and to put them in our lives to make us happy, because God is all that we need. And to begin this process of humbling yourself, it can be very difficult, and I spent a lot of weeks in prayer and in the Word trying to understand more about how to do such a process. But really, it's between you and God. Because I can't tell you and look at you and say, oh, you're playing too many video games, right? Right, no. Because only you know what you're doing in your free time. And God can convict you of those things. And I just pray that you reach out to Him, invite Him into your lives all times. And someone had mentioned to me that prayer, although we say amen, should be in continuous prayer. We should be continuously praying, continuously in conversation with God. And Hannah, she was telling me the other day that when she's driving back and forth to work, she spends 2-3 hours on the road every day to go back and forth to work. She's always praying. And I said, man, I'm not. Why am I not spending time in prayer, giving that time to God? You know, like this is considered free time to me, and I want to know more about Him. Well, I can talk about how much I want to know about God, but am I putting into Him? I know that people can pour into us, and we should pour out into others. You know, we should be continuously filling and pouring, giving. He gives, we give. Right? So, I thank you for this time to be able to share this message that God laid on my heart. And I am so excited to share with you tomorrow the last of this series on the war against sin that we're continuously in, that we continuously battle until the day of the Lord. Thank you again.
Thank you. Well, it's good to be with you one more time. Tomorrow morning, I have a pleasure. Little hiccups there. I have the pleasure of being with you and preaching from John for what it means to be a true worshiper, descriptions of a true worshiper. And then after that meal, churches do this all the time to missionaries. We have this wonderful meal, and then they expect us to passionately preach. And I don't see this, how what we gain from this. I'm up here fat trying to talk, and you're down there tired trying to listen. So we've reserved, my wife and I, we will go through a little bit of our ministry, review quickly, but then we'll have a Q&A after the service, after the morning service and after lunch. A good time for you guys to ask questions publicly. I love question and answer time. I'm a teacher, and I love to ask questions, and I like to be able to answer. So we have our family. We'll just review a little bit. Pray for them. You notice little Ruff Cameron was with us today. He wanted to be with Mommy and Daddy today. So they're getting a little tired also. And we are going to Peru, South America. We'll be in the city of Trujillo. We talked a little bit about that yesterday and what Trujillo looks like. And we are being sent out by North Baptist Church in Flint, Michigan. I had the privilege of being a pastor there for about 4 years. And it is a coastal city. It's beautiful. I'm looking forward to visiting again. I love Michigan, but Michigan gets a little cold, right? Trujillo is the city of eternal spring, they call it. It doesn't get higher than 95 in the summers, and doesn't get any colder than 60 at night in the winters. Tonight I would like to talk to you about the ministries God has called us to in Peru. And really there are three legs. Let's call it our stool of three legs, okay? That we sit on, you know, those bar stools. Is there a better name than bar stool? Milk stool. There we go. Leave it to a farmer's daughter to know. I'm going to use that now. Primarily, we'd be working in Bible colleges, and also we'd be working in churches, because I love the church. I shepherd for many years, and I'd love to continue that. We'll be working with churches that are just starting, planting, also churches that have been around for a while and are struggling. And we'll also be counseling. For the last 5 years, God has allowed my wife and I to be helping out young men and women, specifically recovering, wanting to get right with God, wanting to get rid of those sexual sins and other things that would distract them from the Lord. We want to basically be doing what we've been doing now, but in Peru and all of South America. So let's start with Bible colleges. For the last 5 years, my wife and I have been going down to some Bible college in South America, teaching. Maybe it's the book of Psalms, helping young men and women prepare sermons, Bible studies, lessons from the Psalms. Maybe it's on the Lord's table. What does the Bible say about the Lord's table? We'll spend a week teaching on that. Or maybe just simply, how do we preach? What does it mean to be a missionary? What does it mean to be a gospel minister? And my master's is in systematic theology, which means probably nothing to you, but that's okay. That just means that we learn the doctrines, and we learn them in a way that helps us remember in a systematic way. And some people say, well, that's not really what we think of missionaries. We think about church planters, those pioneers that went down, break the dirt, and establish churches. But I would like to propose to you guys that Bible colleges and the training of young men and women for the ministry is really part of missions and is core to it, is vital to it. Look at what Paul says to Timothy. He says this, "You then, my child, be strengthened by the grace that is in Christ Jesus, and what you have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, entrust to faithful men who will be able to teach others also." And that's what we see in 2 Timothy 2, too. I'm sorry, when I brought up Cameron, I didn't bring up my Bible. So I don't have that in front of me to read the book behind me. But we see here Paul, a seasoned man, talking to Timothy, a guy my age, really, saying, hey, you need to take what you've learned from me, not just me, but in the presence of many witnesses, and entrust it to others so that they can carry on this ministry also. Our goal in Peru is to do just that. Peru missionaries have been there for a while, but it's still not really been fully nationalized. And part of it is because God's doing amazing things. Churches are starting, people are getting saved, but we just don't have enough leaders. Church leaders. And so our desire is to go teach in such a way that those men and women can teach others, and on, so that long after the missionaries are gone, the church in Peru is strong. We want to leave strong roots. Another reason I want to teach in Bible colleges is this. I have a burden for many countries in the world. I'm going to tell you about two countries that I'm really burdened about. One is Senegal. Senegal is on the west side of Africa. Senegal is kind of like what we'd say the Mecca of Islam. But you know what? Despite it being heavily Islamic and Muslim, they're wide open to missionaries coming. They actually say, missionaries, you can come and preach freely here. No persecution. But there aren't any missionaries there. I wish I could just send half of myself there. Or maybe Haiti. Haiti just closed down their Bible college because they didn't have any teachers or any pastors that were able to lead. A country that has just been torn apart because of civil war, torn apart because of just national disaster and poverty. A place that's so dark because of wickedness and witchcraft. Just feels like their light just got a little dimmer. But I can't split myself into three. But you know what I can do? I can go to Bible colleges that are sending out missionaries across the world. And maybe through prayer and just passionate teaching, maybe one of my students will go to Senegal. Maybe a few of my students will go to Haiti and reopen that Bible college. You see, Peru and Brazil are sending out as many, if not more, missionaries than the United States is. Now, they don't look the same way our missionaries do. They kind of just go and figure out finances. They figure out things later. And sometimes their ministry is a little stunted because of that. I have two friends that I went to college with in Peru before I came to the U.S. One of them's in a country in the Middle East, a place I can't get into in his America. I have another friend that's in Africa, in Mozambique, a place I cannot get into as an American. They both called me a couple of years ago and said, Ben, you studied with us. We weren't prepared when we got to our countries. Can you go back to Peru and can you bring the notch up just a little bit so that when we send out missionaries from Peru, they're better equipped? That is our desire going to Peru, is to not just do additional building like church planning, but to do multiplication, teaching many men to go out and train more men and more men. That is Bible college teaching, but now I'd like to propose to you church discipleship. Now this is a little bit different. We understand that churches are supposed to be discipling. That's not really what I'm getting at. Really, it's a ministry of going and helping churches get grounded. Not only when I want to help ground the church in Peru at Bible colleges, I want to get my hands dirty with the churches, getting into the garden. About every month, I get a call from a church or an email that says something like this. Ben, we don't know what we're doing. Can you come and help us? Remember, yesterday I talked about what most of the churches look like. Most of the pastors are either the first one saved or the only one that can read. Churches are blossoming and growing everywhere, but they don't have church leaders. And so when people come from their Catholic background, which is mixed with witchcraft and stuff like that, when they come from Pentecostalism, which oftentimes is void of the gospel, and they come to the church together, they bring those ideas with them because no one's there to help teach them well. We see something similar a couple verses after in 2 Timothy 2, and it says this. Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a worker who has no need to be ashamed, rightly handling the word of God. Our desire is to build up the church this way, disciple it. What does that look like? Well, here's an example. A few years ago, I went to a church north of our city. They had dismissed their pastor because he fell into sexual immorality and would not repent. So they did the right thing. They did a godly thing. But they reached out to me and said, Ben, we don't know what a pastor's supposed to be. We've been hurt. We don't even know what preaching's supposed to be like. Can you come and for a month just teach us all you know about these subjects? And then can you help us have meetings where we take what we've learned from you and make it our own? There are many examples like that where missionaries are so busy working with planning their own church, working at Bible colleges and other ministries, and also helping churches that are struggling. Churches in Peru are not in fear of closing, because they're usually meeting in people's homes, and it's about the people. But false ideas and lack of training is seeping into the church, and that will destroy it in a much worse way. We know in this passage that what happens when false doctrine and sin creeps into the church? It becomes what? Gangrene. And gangrene doesn't just affect one person. One part of your body, what does it do? It spreads. Our goal is to go there and not fix it, but what do you do with gangrene? You cut it off. And you remove it from your life. And that is one way. Another way that we will be working in Peru is actually with counseling. I talked about that a little bit, that we've had that privilege already, working with a few pastors in our area of the Metro Detroit and Flint area, because those pastors are also overworked. And they're struggling. They get hurt too. It's a reminder that sin does not stop with just one person. The hurt spreads. And usually it leads other people to sin. Your sin can be the door for another person to sin. So our desire is to work with those young men and women, those churches, with those people that want to get right with God. Let's look at what Paul says also to Timothy about this subject. Therefore, if anyone cleanses himself from what is dishonorable, he will be a vessel for honorable use, set apart as holy, useful to the master of the house, ready for every good work. Our desire is to not only to go to these Bible colleges, work with these students, and train them up in knowledge, but to also help them mature in their walk with the Lord. We don't want pastors that have all the smarts, but no maturity. That's bad. Actually, if anything, we kind of want it the other way, right? At least a mature man will do well. But better is both, right? Knowledgeable, divide the word well, and also humble and a shepherd. We want both of those things. And that takes a lot of discipleship, a lot of counseling. Our desire is to build relationships with these young men and women, because they are coming with baggage. We all struggle with sin. And Bible college is a great time to get rid of those, so that they can be honorable vessels, fit and holy for the use of the Lord. I'm grateful. The last trip I was able to make was down to Brazil. It was in the time that we're deciding, do we go to Brazil, to Peru? When we went to Baptism and Missions, we said, hey, we're ready to be missionaries. We'll go wherever you want. So for the first couple of months, they're like, well, maybe we'll send you to this island out in the middle of nowhere. They need a pastor. Or maybe we'll send you over here and over there. But then they realized, Ben, you have these set tools. We need you in South America somewhere. Pick one. So we went to Brazil. I taught there for a while. It was beautiful at her parents' place. Because of our boys and the baggage they've come from in their fostering and the terrible home situation they had, our boys have gone through more than any human being should go through. We realized that we were going to need family, co-workers that are able to help us. Part of our ministry is also traveling a little bit. We needed family and co-workers to help raise our children, because it's more than just what normal parents go through. So we're grateful that we finally landed on Trujillo. And of course, how I like to end. Oh, I forgot one ministry. Shame on me. It's because this one just started. It's called In Spirit and in Truth. In Espíritu y en Verdad. It's a website that produces devotionals for anybody that wants it. Every week we release a set of devotionals for 4 days of that week. We want God's people to be in the Word. And some of them just don't know where to go to. Have you ever gotten to an end of a year of doing a devotional like, what's next? This is kind of the solution to that. We have so many Bible studies and devotional books out there. Isn't it amazing? In Peru we don't. In South America we don't. So every week, my wife and I put together basically a list of passages to read, a doctrinal question and answer that they memorize, and then a hymn that they sing. Because we know that the important parts of devotions is prayer, the word, and the doctrine, and singing. And our goal is to replicate that in the churches in Peru. We also produce worship service guides. Now, you need to realize that most pastors don't know what they're doing. So what do? They grab their hymn book, if they have a hymn book, and they go, first song, second song, third song, fourth song. They know that's not right, but they don't know what else to do. So we release worship order of services, worship services, and then they kind of modify it to fit them. They want a topic here, a topic there. That just alleviates the pressure of the pastors as they're preparing for Sunday. And now, how can you pray? Prayer is vital to missionaries. That's why oftentimes I'll go to a church that just, we can't support you. I was like, well, part of my job right now being on deputation is raise awareness for missions and prayer. So here's some ways you can pray. Pray for more labors. I've said this twice. I'm going to say it tomorrow twice also. Matthew 9:38. Pray to the Lord of the harvest that he will send labors to his fields. Pray for those Bible college students. Pray for professors, not just in Peru, but across the world. Even in the U.S., we have a shortage of pastors and professors. In the rest of the world, it's worse. Pray God would raise up godly people amongst the church. Also, pray for counseling. Many opportunities there. Right now, it's hard. I have people reaching out saying, hey, can you help me with this? Or, hey, pastor reaches out and says, hey, I have this situation. Can you help me? And I have to say, well, here's my advice, but really, it's a one-on-one thing. And virtually is not that great sometimes, especially with bad connections. So pray that we would be able to raise our funds to get there soon. There is much work to be done. And also pray for camps. Camps is a great place to get saved, but also a great place to fellowship and to continue your relationship with the Lord. We have two camps. They just finished their camp season. We have many people get saved. Much interest. One of our youth retreats had 400 youth from the churches in their area. They only had bunk beds for 200. They only had mattresses for 300. But Peruvians don't need the elbow room that we need here in the U.S. They pushed all those bunk beds together, put those mattresses together, and they kind of fit a few more in there. The youth wanted to be at camp. They wanted to hear good teaching. They wanted to fellowship with other believers because maybe they are the only person their age in their church. I mean, I was that growing up. No man my age until I got to the U.S. I had camps to help fellowship and build myself up. And then for those that really need salvation. So pray in this way. Pray that God would raise up laborers for his fields. Thank you for your time, Pastor.
Once again, challenged, blessed, and excited what the Lord's going to do through these men, what he's doing through right now. And, you know, the way Brother Ben here closed, and the song that the Holy Spirit laid upon my heart once again for us to close with here tonight, kind of go hand in hand. Song is 668, I'll go where you want me to go. And the question he had, Brazil or Peru, and he's going where the Lord wants him to go in the process. Are we willing to do the same? This young couple over here are going to a place where it has 7 of the out of the top 10 deadliest snakes in the world. Because that's where God has called them to go. Praise God, it's them. I don't mind snakes, but praise God, it's them. You know, he might not be calling us Peru, Australia, Lord's case, Benin, but I know he's called us to here. Minon, Saline, Ann Arbor. And are you willing to go just across the street for him? When Trent and I was talking earlier on in the week and stuff, and he told me something that I know my pastor has taught me for nearly eternity, it seems like. Kidding me? We've been together for over 35 years, so yeah, it's been a long time. But he said, even if God calls you somewhere else, always work till you get there for him where you're at. And that stuck with me. to work diligently hard, and one day, if he does, he'll call me somewhere else, but I want to continue to work there. That's my challenge to both of you. Both of you guys have been doing extremely good at it, and my prayer for you is that. And the rest of us, are you willing to work like that until he calls you home? Because this is our mission, brother, and it needs a lot of help. We need a lot of pastors and teachers here, too, in our home place here with that. So let's stand and sing 668, if you will. I'll go where you want me to go. Once again, we thank you for your word from these men. The challenge that they've laid at our feet, I think of even the chorus and the song we just sang, I'll go where you want me to go, dear Lord, over mountain, plain, or sea. You know, and I think about the time it takes to travel. And even by plane, In the first night to get to Australia, it's 26 hours in a plane. Unfathomable, to me anyways, with that and their willingness, Lord. And I just pray for both of these couples, Lord, and their families. We pray that your hand would be upon them, Lord, that you would raise the necessary funds that they need to get on the field quickly, Lord, that they wouldn't have to wait long, Lord. And I know that I've talked to them, I can see it firsthand with Jordan, some of the frustrations that are going on right now, and the lack of churches willing to even really let people in, let alone support them. And so I pray, Lord, that you just do a mighty work, through your almighty power, Lord, that we'd be able to see them get on the field quickly. And Lord, I pray and trust that if you tarry long enough, that you'll bring us all back again tomorrow morning with a host of others. Lord, that we might come and worship you and just be challenged with your word once again through these men. And we're grateful once again for the time we're able to spend with you tonight. And we pray this in the almighty precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.